You can turn to the book of Hebrews, chapter 1. In the Jewish Passover cells of questions that go on in the evening that explain the significance of Passover specifically as it differs from all other nights. The Passover is a unique celebration that remembers the past bitterness of slavery while celebrating the fact that God delivered his people from that slavery. And the fourth question of the Passover goes like this. It says, on all other nights, we eat either sitting upright or reclining. Why on this night do we recline? And the answer to that question is that though we were once slaves in Egypt, today we realize our freedom and our royalty. Whereas slaves, we stood at the table ready to serve. As royalty, we reclined. In the presence of royalty, one who is not of equal stature either bows or stands by the table waiting to serve. But one who's royal themselves might actually sit down at the table of royalty. This is exactly what Jesus did as he sat down at the royal throne of his Father. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. He who is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, who upholds the universe by the word of his power, after making purifications for sins, he sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We pray that you would use it for your glory and honor, that, Father, it would accomplish what you desire to accomplish. Thank you, Father, for speaking to us. Speak to your people today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The book of Hebrews was written to Jewish believers in Jesus who were perhaps living in Rome. These were a group of believers who understood that Jesus was the Messiah. They came from a background where they understood the Jewish faith. They got it all. They got the temple, the priesthood, the sacrifices, the law, the festivals. They understood it all, but they also understand that Jesus is the Messiah who fulfills it all. And as a result of their faith in Christ as the Son of God, they're persecuted in Rome. They're under considerable suffering. They are finding themselves at the hands of secular governments. Their families, they're watching their family members and their friends and their properties being broken into, their possessions stolen, both they themselves as well as their family and friends. They're wrongfully arrested. They're blamed for the ills of their culture. And over time, this is starting to wear down on them. If they're beginning to, perhaps the persecution is starting to get to them, and they're becoming weaker and weaker and weaker, and they start to forsake the assembling together of themselves to the point where they're being actually tempted to return to the old ways, to return to the world, to go back to their old ways. And Hebrews was written to encourage them that Jesus is greater than your old ways. Jesus is greater than the world, he's greater than your old ways of your religion, and there is nothing in this world that is worth losing him over. Last time we looked at the first two verses of Hebrews, of this letter. We saw how God speaks to mankind in two general phases. In the past, in many times and in many ways, God spoke to and through the prophets. But in these days, which the writer says these last days, he calls them these last days, and remember from a few weeks ago we said it's the last days because it's the days between the first coming of Christ and the second coming. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came into the world, took on flesh. That was the beginning of these last days. And in these last days, the writer says God speaks solely through his Son. As the first two verses reveal that Christ is greater than the prophets, now we're going to see Christ as greater than the kings and ultimately as God himself. We'll find him as our God and our King. Here we find in this text seven facts that are stated about the Son of God. Seven facts that highlight his greatness and his majesty. If you have an outline, you can follow along. These seven facts are, one, he is the heir of all things. Two, he created the universe. Three, he is the radiance of the glory of God. Four, he is the image and essence of God. Five, he holds all things together by his word. Six, he's the great high priest who made purification for sins. And seven, he is the King of Kings who sat down at the right hand of majesty. Let's look at these one at a time, beginning in the second half of verse 2. He was appointed the heir of all things. He was appointed the heir of all things. This is an echo of Psalm 2. I want you to turn to Psalm 2 with me. Psalm 2. I want to read the psalm in its entirety because it's such a relevant psalm for what we're seeing going on in our day and age. Yeah. A psalm that is so relevant to what's going on, particularly in our nation. Psalm 2, read with me, beginning in verse 1. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves against the rulers and take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. This is what we're seeing going on in the world, brothers and sisters. This is the reality. People casting off all restraint. Pastor Eli was sharing on Tuesday night that all of the mayhem that we're seeing going on in the world today is the result of the world's rejection of Jesus Christ. He is the Prince of Peace. He's the answer for the peace that people are looking for, but they won't. People seeking after justice, seeking after peace and equality, that which Jesus came to bring, and the people don't want it. They want it on their terms. They want peace, they want justice, but they want it on their terms, not on the terms of Christ. Continuing on in verse 4 of the psalm, he who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree the Lord said to me. You are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations as your heritage. There's the heirship right there. Ask of me, and I will give the nations as your heritage, the ends of the earth to your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron, dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now, therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way. For his wrath is quickly kindled. Blessed are all those who take refuge in him. The Son of Psalm 2 is the king that God himself installs in place. He appoints him the heir. Again, look at verse 8 again. Ask of me. This is the Lord speaking. And he's speaking to his son. He's speaking to his son, the one whom he's appointed the king. And he says, ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage, and he give the ends of the earth your possession. This is the heirship of the son. This is his kingship, his king, the fulfillment of the one who was coming, who would be as the king, the son of David. Elsewhere in Scripture, it refers to Jesus as the begotten Son, the firstborn. This does not mean that Jesus was born. I'm going to go through a lot today of some of what is called the doctrine of Arianism or the doctrines of the Jehovah's Witnesses, that they don't believe that Jesus is God. I'm going to touch on some of that today. And they will say, well, look, Jesus is the firstborn. He can't be God. He's a creation of God. But that's not what it speaks about here. It's talking about how Jesus has the position of the firstborn son. That is, he has the legal right that he is the heir of all things. The kingdom of God and everything in it is given finally and eternally to Jesus Christ as the King of Kings. He is the heir of all things. Ephesians 1 talks about this. Ephesians 4 talks about this. But then moving on, the Son of God is both appointed heir of all things as well as he's the one through whom the universe was created. He's the creator of the universe. Look at verse 3, how it concludes here. Actually, you're skipping ahead a little bit. Okay, verse 3.
through whom
also he created the worlds.
Through whom
he created the worlds. The worlds here doesn't only refer to the natural planets, but the Greek word aionos, it's a plural word meaning the ages. So Jesus is not only the creator of all that we see with our eyes, he's the creator of the ages. Time, space, energy, matter are all made through Jesus Christ. John agrees with this in John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him. In Colossians 1:16, it says, "For by him all things were created, in heaven and in earth, visible and invisible, thrones, dominions, rulers, authority. All things were created through him and for him." Amen. Through him and for him. The writer of Hebrews wants us to understand that this is God who he's talking about. In the end of it all, everything belongs to Christ. He created it at the beginning and he concludes it at the end. Who is he? He is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. Amen. And further, if you look down, that was the end of verse 2, but look down into verse 3. It describes Jesus as upholding the universe by the word of his power. He upholds the universe. That word is the word pharaoh in Greek, and it means he maintains, he sustains it. So he's not just the Alpha and the Omega. He's not just the beginning and the end, but he's everything in between. He holds it all together. Colossians 1:17 says, "He is before all things, and in him all things hold together." So he owns it all because he created it all. He rules over it all. He sustains it. He sustains every last ocean, every last river, every last heavenly body in the sky. Nothing's going to fall apart because he is keeping it. He's sustaining it, including every single one of the citizens of his creation. He keeps us and he sustains us. People say the world is falling apart. Well, yes, maybe the world is falling apart. But if so, it is only because it is at his word that he is allowing it to dismantle, because he sustains it all. Verse 3 continues to with two more attributes of God, but attributes of this one, Jesus Christ. Verse 3, he is the radiance of the glory of God. The radiance. The writer of Hebrews here is making analogy to the sun. We can look up, some of you are there, can look up and see the sun. What do you see? Do you see the sun? You really don't see the sun. You see the rays that are coming from the sun. You see the radiance. And you say, look, the sun, right? But that's the radiance that you're actually seeing. The writer of Hebrews is comparing the glory of God to the sunlight. Jesus is the Word who reveals the Father. And like the sun rays reveal the S-U-N, sun, in the same way, the rays, the radiance of the S-O-N, though distinct from the Father, nevertheless radiate from the Father, from God. As we cannot know the Son apart from the rays, in the same way we cannot know God except by his Son. And those Arians and their successors, the Jehovah's Witnesses and others who deny the deity of Christ, and you'll see this more and more in our age. More and more people are going to start to deny. They're going to claim to be evangelicals, but they're going to start to deny that Jesus is God. They'll say, can we really know if Jesus is God? Let me tell you, there's no question that Jesus is God. Amen. Those who would deny his deity and say, oh, wait a minute, he's saying he's the radiance. He's the rays. He's not the sun. They're introducing something into this text that is not intended. It is unquestionably the intent of the author to show us that Jesus is Jehovah God. And if you think about it in light of the sun, by the comparison, there's no way that we can, that the sun can exist without rays, right? You can't have the sun without the rays of sun. They cannot be separated. The radiance of the sun, the S-U-N, is co-eternal with the sun. When the sun started to shine, the rays came out. Just as Christ is co-eternal with the Father. The radiance of the actual glory of the Son is radiating out. As rays are to the sun, so Christ is to God the Father. Separate, but not essentially different. Rays can be said to be eternally begotten. The rays of the sun are not being made They're not created, but they're eternally coming out from the sun. In the same way that rays of sunlight are an extension of the sun, ever emanating from the sun, so Christ is eternally begotten of the Father, not made, not created, but eternally emanating from God. So Christ is eternally begotten of the Father, not made, not created. And also, as we see the sun, by means of its rays, we see God by means of his Son. All that we see when we look at the sun are the rays. And we say that those rays are an exact representation of the sun. We're not seeing an image, right? We're not seeing a painting. Someone could paint the sun. That's a painting. That's different. That's an image. When we look at the rays, we're not seeing an image or a painting. We're seeing the streaming forth of the radiance of the sun. And I believe this is a clear intention of the author of Hebrews to demonstrate for us that Jesus Christ is God Almighty. If that's not yet clear, the author goes on to state it even more clearly. He says that Jesus is the very imprint of God's nature. The imprint of his nature. In Greek, it's character, tes, hupostasios. Literally, he bears the stamp of God. Hupostasios is substance or nature. He has the nature, the substance of God. The author of Hebrews here uses this word to refer to the oneness of God. The Father and the Son have the same nature. Jesus is the exact imprint of that nature. Again, when you try to introduce distinctions here that deny that Jesus is God, and you say something like, well, it doesn't say he's God. How come he doesn't say he's God? The author's going, bending over backwards to show you he's God. And there are people say, he's not saying he's God. He's the imprint of God. He's like looking at a picture of God. No. You see, that's where this extreme literalism is responsible for a lot of false doctrine. It's an example. That's what the cults do. They'll try to get you to question little words. The whole picture here of Hebrews 1, the first four verses, is that Jesus is God. He's the exact expression, the nature, the being, the substance of God. As Paul writes to the Philippians of Christ, being in very nature God, he did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped. These are staggering truths about Jesus Christ in the book of Hebrews, and they're directed to the audience to win our confidence and our admiration and our trust and our allegiance and our worship for Jesus Christ. He is both the Son of God and God the Son of man and the Son of God. And it's awe-inspiring to know this about Jesus, his two natures. We'll talk about next time when we get into Jesus specifically as the Son of God. But this is like an awe-inspiring thing here. It's what we need as human beings. We need to identify. See, our finite humanity requires something that we can grasp a hold of. We need something that we can understand, a human form. But at the same time, we have this deeper desire for something infinite, something beyond which is finite. And God answers both of our needs. He knows our need, and he answers it in his Son. As human beings, if we just had an unincarnate deity who we can't actually connect with, in the same way as the incarnate God, there would be a lack. The conception of a God who never became man, whether it's Allah of Islam or the God of Judaism, will not satisfy the human soul like a God who took on human flesh and identified with us. And this is all mind-blowing truth, and it is meant to heighten our confidence, heighten the confidence of our faith. And that's what the author is doing here. He's building this otherworldly description of Jesus here in the first couple of verses. But he doesn't end there. He goes on. This cosmic creator, this sustainer of the universe, this Son of God is not just out there. He took on flesh and dwelled among us. He was equal with God, but he took upon himself the nature of man. And this is even more amazing. Beyond just looking at this God-man Jesus as someone that we could better identify with, he gives us this amazing gospel revelation here. Why did God take on flesh? Why did Jesus become a man? He became a man for us. For us. The personal union of God and man in Christ is personal. In Christ, God has demonstrated his love for us, and that while we were sinners, he took upon himself our nature, and he died for us. Or as verse 3 continues, after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Jesus took on the form of a servant in order to make purification for sins. Let's look at that sentence for a minute. He made purification for sins. What's going on here? Just look, break that down. He made purification for sins. First, who's the subject? Who's the one who made purification for sins? Jesus. Jesus Christ. Purification for sins is not a religious idea. It's not something that we do. It's not a ritual. It's not washings. It's not going and praying five times a day. It's not washing your hands. It's purification for sins is in a person. He made purification for sins. He made, past tense, aorist participle here, or better, after making, or having made. These things were done by Jesus in the past. And what did he make? He made what? Purification. Purification. God gave his son to die for our sins so that we could be forgiven, so that our sins could be separated as far as the east is from the west, so that our hearts could be made pure. He takes out a stony heart and he puts in a heart of flesh. He made purification. In the gospel, in the cross, Jesus does it all. He made purification. And then what from what? He made purification from sins. Sin is a terrible and great reality in the world, something we don't often like to think about. But, brothers and sisters, sin is why the ethnicities today are in an uproar within our own nation. I have no question that God is angry at sin. But it's one thing to say God is angry at sin and angry at the sin that's going on in our nation. He is. It's one thing to say that God is angry with the murder of a black man by a police officer. It's one thing to say that God is angry with all the rioting and looting and the deaths in our streets. But it's quite another thing to deal with the fact that God is angry with our sin. God is angry with our sin. All sin angers God. And all have sinned. See? You might say, well, I'm not among the rioters and thieves, and I'm not a murderer. But when you look at God's standard, have you ever told a lie? You've broken God's law. Have you ever lusted in your heart? Have you ever hated another human being? Have you ignored God? Have you used his name in vain? Have you loved other things more than God? I think we could say guilty, guilty, guilty on all of these things. Have you desired something that is not yours? Have you dishonored your parents? See, we're all guilty of breaking God's law. If we put our lives up against the standard of the Ten Commandments, we are guilty of breaking the law of God. And as a result, God is angry, and he's angry with your and my sin. And the wages of sin is death, and because of sin, we die. And you know what? The news doesn't get much better after that. Because after that, it says, once you die, you stand before God in the judgment. God's standard of judgment is his holy law. So when the law is read, that law which we all admit we've broken, and we find out that God doesn't grade on a curve, but he requires perfection. He says, be holy as he is holy. We have a huge problem on our hands. See, that's why that word sin is so important. We need purification for sin. We have this huge problem because we're going to bear the judgment that our sin deserves as a lawbreaker. And what is the penalty for that? The penalty is an eternal hell, where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. And you say, whoa, wait a minute. Why is it you got to talk about hell? Listen, there is a reason that Jesus preached about hell. There's a reason he spoke about hell more than he spoke about heaven. And it wasn't only to cause us to be fearful, although that's part of it. But realize eternal judgment magnifies God. Because the severity of sin is not in the specific nature of the sin. You could say, well, I'm not as bad as those rioters in the street. I'm not as bad as that police officer who killed that guy. I'm not like that. See, that's what's happening in the world today. People are pointing, I'm not like them, I'm not like them. But the bottom line is, God doesn't grade on a curve. And the severity of sin is not in the specific nature of the sin, but in the nature of the one that we sin against, who is the eternal God. So the penalty is eternal, as the one who we have sinned against is eternal, eternally good, and eternally righteous. So God's holy anger against sin, then, is why we need purification from sin. And you can't purify yourself, but by grace, you can be saved through faith, through a salvation that is not of yourselves, not of the result of your good works or your morality or your law-keeping, but by the result of the finished work of Christ, dying on your behalf, paying the price for your sin, and making purification for sin. That which you could not do for yourself, Christ did for you, and he offers it to you today as a free gift that you can receive from him. He bore sin. He bore the sin of every single one who would believe in him. And he did it once, and he did it once for all time on the cross, never to be repeated, because that sin-bearing work is perfect. This is what the book of Hebrews is all about. We're going to keep coming back to this as we go through Hebrews over the next year. Keep coming back to this whole point. The perfect, sin-bearing work of Christ was perfect work. To the Jewish audience who were listening on, they were familiar with how purifications of sins was made. How? Through animal sacrifice. One after the next, the priests in the temple would offer up sacrifice after sacrifice after sacrifice, and the priest's work was never complete. When you look at all the furniture, Brother Jim's taken us through Exodus, any seats in there? No seats, right? No place to sit down. There's a beautiful lampstand. There's the Ark of the Covenant. There's the table of showbread. No place to sit down. Why? Because the priest was ever working, sacrifice after sacrifice. And then when one priest was done, the next one just came right in. There were millions upon millions of goats and calves and lambs that were being slaughtered. And they could only temporarily cover sin, but never fully take it away. No rest for the high priest in the temple who offered up sacrifice. No resting place, no place to sit down in the holy place, because the high priest's work was never finished. But not so for our high priest. Not so for our Jesus. His work is finished, and his work pleased God, and his work satisfied his wrath. And the resurrection is proof of that fact. In contrast to the high priest in the temple, we have Jesus Christ, who made once and for all purification for sins by dying in our place, rising from the dead, and ascending to the right hand of the Father, where today he sat down at his right hand. And that's what I want to focus on for the remainder of our time today. Where Jesus went, where he is now. Very important, verse 3. He sat down. He sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Jesus spoke about this. The New Testament is full of this. You just want to do a search on your internet. You want to do a study when you get home. Search right hand. And amazing how many verses in the New Testament it talks about the right hand of God. In Matthew 26, Mark 14, and Luke 22, Jesus said to the high priest, he says, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of God. And this is all over the New Testament. The Apostles' Creed confesses, on the third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God. It's a common idea in Christian faith, in the Bible, in the church. And it's the main idea of this text. The main sentence of this text is, he sat down. That's the main subject and the main verb of all of verse 3. He sat down. I want now to take you through how the Holy Spirit moved the writer of Hebrews to pen verse 3. It's one clause. It has one subject. And you can miss this in English, by the way. It could look like three clauses with three separate sentences, with three subjects and three verbs. But it's actually not. It's one subject. Christ, he, and then one main verb, sat down. I want to show you this. One clause in the entire verse 3, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Everything else around in verse 3 supports that statement. Look again at verse 3. It's a lengthy statement. It is rightly compacted into a single verse. It ought to be one verse because it is one thought here. It is not three sentences with three separate verbs. It's actually one verb and the others are participles. Let's read it in English first, then I'll explain. Look at verse 3 again. Follow along with me in English. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. Now, if we look at this in Greek and we understand participles and verbs, it would be better understood this way. Still follow along in your Bibles, but I'm going to read it with the understanding of translating the participles the way they ought to be. Who, being the radiance of the glory, an exact expression of his substance, upholding all things through the word of his power, and making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. So you see that? Those preliminary things are leading you up to that main point, that he sat down. What the author wants us to understand is what it is that makes it fitting that Christ should sit down at the right hand. What right does Christ have to sit down, this carpenter from Nazareth? What right does he have to sit down at the right hand of the majesty of God? Because, you see, if you think Jesus is just a carpenter, if you think he's just a prophet, if you think he's just a good person, and you're Jewish and you're used to reciting the central declaration of your faith, Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, the idea that a man can come and ascend to the right hand of God is blasphemy. Remember when Jesus was on trial before the high priest, and he made the assertion, he said, I am the Messiah, the Son of God, and he says that you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of God, the Mighty One. What did the high priest do? He tore his clothes. He said, this is blasphemy. Do we need any more evidence? Out of the man's mouth, he's a blasphemer. And they condemned him to death. The writer of Hebrews doesn't want his audience to have that same reaction. He wants them to understand that this is not blasphemy. So he's saying to them, he's stating it this way, and again, it's in your notes to follow along. He's saying this way. He's saying, he, being the radiance of his glory, sat down at the right hand of majesty. He, being the exact representation of God's nature, sat down at the right hand of majesty. He, upholding all things by the word of his power, sat down at the right hand of majesty. And he, having made purification for sins, sat down at the right hand of majesty. See, he sat down because he had the right to sit down. Because he is Jehovah God. And if he's not God, then yes, that was blasphemy. See, this is the problem that Jehovah's Witnesses face. And all of the previous forms that exist out there of denying the deity of Christ. You have to admit that Jesus sat down at the right hand of majesty. You can't get around that fact. This idea is all over the New Testament. There are literally dozens of verses that say this, that Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. So you have a real problem, because the right hand of God is part of who God is. In the Old Testament, when it spoke of the right hand of God, This was the location of the power of God, the mercy of God, the salvation of God, His wrath, His judgment. It was also the place of safety and refuge and appeal and worship. So you couldn't separate God from His right hand. They were used synonymously. I want to show you one place. Turn to Psalm 110. We're going to be in Psalm 110 quite a bit because it really is linked to the book of Hebrews. Some commentators have actually said that the book of Hebrews is an exposition of Psalm 110. So it's very much linked. Psalm 110. I want to go through most of it with you. Look at the word of God with me. Psalm 110. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. So you see right there, the one who is seated at the Lord's right hand is who? The Lord. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand. So there you have that. The psalmist gives us more specifics then about this king. Look at verse 2. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. So he's a king. This one who is at the right hand is a king. He's also a priest. Look at verse 4. This is going to come back to in weeks to come. Look at verse 4. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. So he's the Lord. He's the king. He's a priest. Look at verse 5. He's God. Look at verse 5. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath. He will execute judgment among the nations. So at the right, who's at the right hand of the Lord? The Lord is at the right hand of the Lord. So to discover now, when you come to the New Testament, that this is Jesus, if he is not God, you have a real problem. Because then what you've done, if Jesus is not God, and you see him as some exalted man, divine exalted man, then what you're doing is you're taking a human being and exalting him to a place of omniscience, omnipotence, mercy, salvation, judgment, and worship that is due God alone. And all of a sudden, what have you done? You've actually made another God with a small g. And that's what they do. With Jesus, they make him into another God with a small g. Jehovah's Witnesses don't realize that if Jesus is not God, then they are idolaters because they have exalted man to the right hand of God. The author of Hebrews' intention early on in this letter is to say, this Jesus, and he's encouraging the people. This Jesus who you are bearing reproach for, this Jesus who you're being persecuted for, this Jesus who you're even thinking about possibly walking away from, he's God. And if you walk away from him, you're turning your back on Yahweh. You're turning your back on the one true God, and you will incur all of the curse and eternal wrath associated with that sin. Look at the statements briefly. I'll look at two at a time here. The first two reveal who Christ is that qualifies him. And then second two, what he did. I'll try to do this very quickly. Who is Christ that he's qualified to sit at the right hand? Well, he's the radiance of the glory and the exact representation of his nature. Who is it that's sitting at the right hand of God? It's Christ. He's the radiance of his glory, the exact representation of his nature. That is to say, to see Christ is to see God. Jesus said, if you see me, you've seen the Father. He's the image of the invisible God. Doesn't mean, again, that Christ represents God the way that I've heard people say. Christ represents God the way the president writes a letter and puts his seal, or the king writes a decree and puts a seal of his wax, and that's Christ. No, not at all. If that were the case, then Christ would have no right whatsoever to sit down at the right hand of majesty. He is the Word who was with God in the beginning and God. And this, again, clear idea is being presented in Hebrews here. that Jesus Christ has the right to sit down because of who he is, his divine nature. But then not only because of who he is, but also because of what he has done. He's earned the right. Not only does he have the right in his person, but he's earned the right. How? Look at the next two statements about his work. First, Hebrews 1, verse 3, he upholds all things by the word of his power. He's upholding all things by the words of his power. He's the sustainer. He's the preserver of all. We're going to see in a minute he purifies from our sins, but we can't forget that he sustains us. He keeps us. He's the sustainer of everything. He holds it all together. The universe is fragile. It's hanging by a thread. One word from Christ and it can go out of existence in a moment. Just as the universe exploded into existence by one word, it can implode out of existence by one word, Christ. He is the sustainer of the universe and he's the sustainer of our faith. Amen? We need Christ or else we're not going to make it, brothers and sisters. We need him. Not only to make purification for sins, we also need him to provide preservation, protection to our souls, to our bodies, if we're going to make it to the end. There's temptations all around us to pull us back. If we're going to make it, we need Christ. Brethren, we're going through a very unusual time in the history of our world and the history of the church. God ordained for us one day out of seven to come together to worship him. One day out of seven to come together and strengthen one another by our assembling together. One day out of seven. And without it, we end up becoming weak. We end up becoming weak. We need the means of grace regularly. We need to meet together every week. That's what strengthens us. And you may not realize it now, but I know this is true about me. And if you don't realize it, I think you will. I think God will reveal it to you. That you might be at one of the weakest points in your life as a result of not meeting together. You don't understand. We don't understand how the assembling together of ourselves encourages our faith. One day out of seven. This might offend some, but you know what? I don't care at this point. Maybe someone will wake up. But if you look at the weakest Christians in our church, it's the ones who tend to forsake the assembling together. And let that fall upon whoever it falls upon. The weakest members of our church, I'm talking about our local church, are those who forsake the assembling together. Further, do not doubt for a moment that each and every one of us is significantly weaker today than we were 84 days ago when we last met. You say, no, yeah, I'm still here, I'm alive, I still love Jesus. If you're here and you're alive and you still love Jesus, that's an unusual measure of sustaining grace. That he's bestowing sustaining grace because of the season that we're in. But we can't fool ourselves to think that our faith is completely unaffected during this time of abstinence. We need sustaining grace, and Christ ministers that sustaining grace as we gather together. And when we see Jesus seated at the right hand of majesty, it is not only to honor his work in purification and saving us, but also to honor the fact that he has sustained us. And God willing, next week when we assemble back together, we're going to be celebrating the fact that he sustained us for a total of 91 days, 3 months. And finally, consider the connection between the work of Christ and making purification for sins and his seat at the right hand of majesty. Turn over to Hebrews 10. I'm winding down. And I have to, but my iPad's going to run out of energy with 3%. So I'd have to make up the end of this sermon. Consider the connection. Siri just thought I talked to her. I didn't. Consider the connection between the work of Christ in making purification for sins and his place seated at the right hand of majesty. Hebrews 10, verse 12. He, having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God. Same thing as chapter 1. Having offered the sacrifice for sins for all time, he sat down. So chapter 1, having made purification for sins, he sat down. So there's a connection between Jesus having finished the work of atonement and sitting down. He bore the wrath of God on the cross. It's done in its completeness. And now he takes the seat of honor. Hebrews 10, look at verse 13. It adds a little bit more information here. He is seated, verse 13, waiting for the time onward until his enemies be made a footstool for his feet. For by one offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. He sat down at the right hand, waiting for his enemies to be subdued. For, ground clause there, gar in Greek. For by one offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. There's a cause effect that the author of Hebrews is bringing out here. Jesus sits in the place of honor and power. Jesus sits down at the place of honor and power for, because his offering on the cross was perfect. 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 His offering was perfect. It saved and sanctified every single human being for whom it was intended. The sacrifice of Jesus saved and sanctified every single human being for whom it was intended. So Jesus sits in the place of honor and power because his offering was perfect. Every last one who he died for will be saved. And every last one who he died for will not only be saved, but will conform to the image of Christ from one degree of glory to another. And it will be without question that every single one for whom he has died for will be raised on the last day. Now, do you get that? Do you understand that? That Christ completely covered your sin so completely that you can be counted perfect before God. Not just now, but for all time. That if you're in Christ, for all time, his once shed blood continually pleads for you before the throne. Mm-hmm. And because of this, and because of what he has done in saving his people, he is exalted to the right hand of God. He is sat down. So back in chapter 1, verse 3, when he had made purification for sins, of sins, he sat down at the right hand of majesty. It means that the sitting down says to all creation, this Christ is qualified for this place of honor because of what he's done. Because he shed his blood. Now this has a number of implications as we look at finally at application. First of all, it's that he's worthy of praise and honor and worship. And we see this playing out in Revelation chapter 5, where you have this vision of heaven. And the scroll is in the right hand of the one who sits on the throne. And there's lamenting going on. No one's found worthy. Who can open the scroll? Until one steps forward. The lion of the tribe of Judah. The root of David who's conquered. He, why? By virtue of the fact that he conquered. He is able to open the scroll. He conquered sin. So he has the right to open the scroll. And this lion is also described as a lamb who was slain. And he takes the scroll from the right hand of the one who is seated on the throne. He has the right to. And what happens right after that? Heavenly worship. The 24 elders sing, worthy are you to take the scroll and open its seals. For you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. Hallelujah. Brethren, Christ's place of honor at the right hand of majesty motivates worship. Let us worship him who even the angels sing. He'll say, what's middle of June, why are we singing Hark the Herald Angels Sing in the middle of June? Isn't that a Christmas hymn? No, it's about the angels singing, and we're invited to join the chorus of the angels, of the one who is alone worthy. Worthy, proven by his person and proven by his work. Brethren, trust him and love him and worship him. He's alive today. He's seated at the right hand of God with all power and authority. He's coming back in great glory. Worship the Son. Then also he sat down, demonstrating the fact that he is royal. He's the King of Kings. 1 Peter 3, verse 22 says, he's gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers, having been subjected to him. So when Jesus ascends, all the angels, all the authorities, and all the powers are now subject to him because he's the only king. There are not a number of thrones in heaven. There are not a few thrones in heaven. There's not a throne in heaven for Buddha and another one for Krishna and another one for Muhammad. No, there is one throne for one person, Jesus Christ, our King. We see his royalty in the vision. Isaiah chapter 6, that very famous chapter, the call of Isaiah into ministry. And he, God reveals himself as seated on the throne. And he says, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his robe, the train of his robe filled the temple, and I saw the seraphim, and they had six wings, they covered their eyes, they covered their feet, and they were flying around, and he said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is full of his glory. Well, that was a vision of Yahweh, and his train of his robe is filling the temple, and the seraphim surrounding him are singing his praises. They're praising this king. They're praising this king whose robe fills the temple. They're proclaiming his holiness. And Isaiah couldn't explain it all, but in the New Testament, in the Gospel of John chapter 12, the apostle tells us who that was, who Isaiah saw. And in John 12, verse 41, speaking of Jesus, John says, Isaiah said these things because he saw his glory and spoke of him. Isaiah had actually seen a pre-incarnate Christ and his royal throne, his royal robe filling the temple, the train of his robe filling the temple. Well, what can Isaiah do in that kind of situation? He's being commissioned by God. He sees this vision of God. God tells him now to go to the nations and preach. What is Isaiah going to say? No? No, he says, here am I, send me. So, brethren, what can we learn from this? By the royalty of Christ at the right hand, the exalted place of God, of Christ at the right hand of majesty, reveals that he's your king. He's your king, and we need to obey him and follow him. We don't do too well in our country when it comes to authority. Mm-hmm. We have authority figures, and we mock them. Mm-hmm. We have authority figures, and we take advantage of them. Yeah. But in a monarchy, let me tell you something, you don't do that. You don't disobey a king. Mm-hmm. The king, by virtue of his position, is obeyed. As I heard it said, you can't say, no, Lord. Because the moment you say no, he is not Lord. The moment you say no, he is not Lord, you are. Mm. So may Christ's royal place at the right hand of majesty cause us to obey and follow him, to turn from sin and toward him. Next, the fact that he sat down after finishing the work enables us to rest. See that? He said, after he made the sacrifice of himself, Jesus what? Sat down. Meaning what? There was nothing for him to do anymore when it came to the work of salvation. Nothing more to do. He has given you all that you need to be right with God. And he did it once, and he did it for all. He has given you all you need to be right with God, to be what you're supposed to be, to do that which you're called to do. He's given it to you all. What a comforting truth that is, brothers and sisters, to know that. To know that he has given me what I need. The work is finished by someone who is infinitely greater than I. I can't continue that work. It's comforting to know that all that was necessary for your full salvation has been accomplished by the omnipotent one. Every single human being for whom Jesus died has entered into a saving union with him. And as Jesus rose from the dead, all too who are in Christ will be raised on that last day. So cease striving. Cease working to try to earn your place of salvation. None of the sheep for whom he's laid down his life will be lost. Let the good works that we do, let it flow out of gratitude. Let the good works that you do flow out of the gratitude for his finished work. Not to try to earn your place. Rest. Rest trusting in his finished work. What a word that is for our day, right? I mean, we're in such turmoil in our nation. We need to embrace rest. And this is what this is meant to do, to encourage you, to make you unshakable with all the temptations that are going on all around you, to make it unshakable that you would have no doubt that you are forgiven in Christ. And I pray every time you think of these three words, he sat down, those three words, all of the doubt would fly away.
Amen.
That he sat down would kindle in you a desire to celebrate God's amazing grace. That that would bring revival to your heart, revival of love and devotion. Lastly, may Christ's place at the right hand of majesty empower you for intercession. May we pray boldly, brothers and sisters. If ever there was a time that God's people need to pray, it is now. We have a faithful high priest who, in the words of Hebrews, ever lives to make intercession for us. Romans 8, verse 34 says that he sat down to intercede for us. It says Jesus Christ, the one who died, more than that, was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Hallelujah. Can there be any greater encouragement for us to pray than to know that the King of Kings, the one whom the angels worship, who created all and sustained all, is now seated at the right hand of majesty? And you really think there's a chance you're not going to make it? You really think that Jesus' prayers are not being heard? You really think that his prayers are not effectual? Is it possible that God would not hear the intercession from his very right hand? My brother, my sister, no. He is our faithful high priest. He's the final prophet and the faithful high priest who sat down, having cleansed his people, and he is reigning from the place of chief honor. So worship him, obey him, rest in him, and pray accordingly. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus Christ, for sending him to take on flesh and dwell among us. How we are a needy people, Lord, because we could not save ourselves, even our best efforts could not save us. And we thank you that you have completed the work in sending your Son. We pray, O God, that we would be a people who would be characterized by worship. And Father, as we long to gather again together, when we do, Lord, just fill our worship, fill our praises, O God. Fill our mouths with singing. And Lord, in areas of our lives where we have strayed, temptations that we have given into, Lord, cause your people to obey. As we consider the right hand, the royal one at your right hand, may we know that he is our Lord, that we might obey him. And may we rest, O God, in the finished work. And may we also, Lord, pray, knowing that he is at your right hand and you hear him. Father, thank you for your word. Please use it to strengthen us. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.